We're back in business. Thank you for staying with us through the final session. So I'm delighted, really delighted, that our keynote speaker is Howard Shelanski, the administrator of the Office of Information Regulatory Affairs, OIRA, about which much has been said in this conference, including in the last panel. And as you know, OIRA is part of the White House Office of Management and Budget. Those of you who are in the room and therefore found this conference interesting, or at least ex ante interesting, know that Howard is, from our perspective, close to the most important official in the federal government. His office reviews significant federal regulations to ensure compliance with the president's executive order that requires, among other things, that those regulations be justified by reference to cost-benefit analysis. Howard is uniquely prepared for this challenging assignment. He is both a lawyer and an economist. He's a successful academic and also a distinguished and experienced public servant. Howard has excelled at everything he has done. He obtained his law degree and his PhD in economics from the University of California at Berkeley. He then was a law clerk to Judge Stephen Williams of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit, another serious student of administrative law. For the legendary Lewis Pollack of the United States District Court for the Eastern District of Pennsylvania, perhaps the iconic district court judge of the 20th century. And then for Justice Antonin Scalia of the Supreme Court of the United States, and among other things, a former chair of the Administrative Conference of the United States. He has been a tenured member of the faculties at Berkeley and Georgetown, which is very impressive. Perhaps most importantly, he has been a visiting professor of law here at NYU Law School. In the government, Howard has served as senior economist of the President's Council of Economic Advisors and chief economist of the Federal Communications Commission during the Clinton administration. In this administration, he has served as director of economics of the Federal Trade Commission before becoming the OIRA administrator on June 27th of this year. I understand that this is Howard's first public address to a group outside of the government, outside of Washington. We're very honored that he came to do this here at NYU Law School. And I can tell you Howard made enormous efforts under very challenging circumstances to actually come and address us today. So we are very grateful to him. Howard, it's great to welcome you back to the law school.
Thanks very much, Ricky. Well, thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here. I want to apologize for keeping you all here. I would like to have been here earlier. It just wasn't possible. So I'm really grateful for your presence and for your patience this afternoon. I also wish to thank Dean Revesz and the Institute for the invitation to speak with you today. It is a real pleasure to be back here at NYU, where I was fortunate, as Ricky mentioned, a few years ago to spend a semester as a visiting professor. And it is a particular honor to be here today in such a distinguished company, especially that of my predecessors at OIRA, who you saw on the last panel, Sally Katzen, Boyden Gray, and Boris Bernstein. And a particular pleasure to be here in the presence of a very distinguished NYU law graduate, my mother. Okay, in my remarks to you today, I would like to first to outline my priorities as administrator, and to update you on some of the progress we are making on various fronts at OIRA. I would then like to talk briefly about some dimensions of cost-benefit analysis and their importance for good regulatory policy. As you know, OIRA has a broad portfolio that extends beyond regulatory review. For example, under the Paperwork Reduction Act, the office is responsible for reviewing collections of information by the federal government to ensure that they're not overly burdensome. OIRA also provides guidance on privacy policy to federal agencies and oversees the implementation of government-wide information quality and statistical standards. One of our current challenges and high priorities is to work with colleagues across the government to ensure that federal policy in each of these areas adapts to the ever-changing technological environment and the evolving needs of both government and those it serves. The largest area of OIRA's work, however, is, of course, the review of regulations promulgated by executive branch departments and agencies. Executive Orders 12866 and 13563, of which I understand there has been some discussion already today, delineate processes for regulatory review and, importantly, establish standards and analytic requirements for rulemaking by departments and agencies. It is pursuant to these executive orders that cost-benefit analysis can, where legal and feasible, play a central role in agency rulemaking and OIRA's review of resulting regulations. Other important executive orders focus on reduction of regulatory burdens through retrospective review of existing rules. Those would be EOs 13563 and 13610, and on international regulatory cooperation, EO 13609. And those are all executive orders that have come down during President Obama's first term. OIRA's current priorities are directly rooted in the relevant executive orders. One such priority is to increase the predictability of the regulatory review process by improving the timeliness and transparency of OIRA's key functions. I heard there was some reference in the last panel to a Roach Motel. Well, we're trying to make it a little less roachy. In that regard, OIRA is working not only to ensure that we publish the Unified Agenda and Regulatory Plan for agency rulemaking activity twice each year, but to make the Unified Agenda more informative as well as more timely, so that it is a more accurate reflection of what agencies actually will do going forward. Such notice improves transparency and better enables stakeholders to plan for the future. Of similar importance to clarity and certainty of the regulatory environment is that rules, both new rules and those already under review, move through OIRA as efficiently as resource constraints and rigorous analysis permit. It has been our highest recent priority to reduce the frequency of extended regulatory reviews and to work with agencies on rules that are already under extended review. OIRA's consideration of federal regulations must first and foremost uphold the standards of analysis that the executive orders establish. But unnecessary delays in review are harmful to everyone, to those who lose the benefits of regulation, to those who wish to comment on proposed rules and influence policy, and to those who must plan for any changes the regulations require of them. Thanks to the tireless work of OIRA staff in the months before and since my arrival, we have more than cut in half the number of rules that were under review for more than 200 days. And the number of rules under review for more than 90 days, the basic timeline established in the executive orders, is down considerably and continues to fall. I will say that the government shutdown certainly did not help in this endeavor, but we are working hard to overcome that setback and expect to continue to move on track in the coming weeks. While increasing the predictability of the regulatory process through timely review of rules and publication of regulatory plans and agendas is essential, the executive orders also make clear that flexibility and removal of unnecessary burdens are essential elements of the federal rulemaking process. Even regulations that were well-crafted when first promulgated can become unnecessary or excessively burdensome over time and with changing conditions. Retrospective review of regulations already on the books, also called regulatory look-back, helps to ensure that those regulations are continuing to help promote the safety, health, welfare, and well-being of Americans without imposing unnecessary costs. Agencies filed their most recent retrospective review plans with OIRA in July. OIRA completed its review of those plans a few weeks later, and agencies have posted them on their websites. As I testified before Congress in July, agencies' retrospective review efforts to that point had already produced significant results, bringing near-term cost savings of more than $10 billion to the U.S. economy. As agencies move forward with their current plans, OIRA will work with them to achieve even greater gains. It is important to note that retrospective review is not only a mechanism for removing rules from the books, but a process for identifying possible improvements and changes to existing rules. Retrospective review is thus a process that uses not only an eraser, but also an editor's blue pencil. Look back is not, in general, the easy task some might imagine of hacking away at mounds of obsolescent rules. Indeed, as the low-hanging fruit of retrospective review is quickly gathered, the task will become increasingly challenging. But it is a challenge we must meet. Regulatory review should not be a one-way ratchet, but a process that removes unnecessary burdens while keeping beneficial regulation up to date and dynamic. There is no doubt a long line of entities ready to show OIRA and the agencies where to apply an eraser to eliminate costs. Reducing costs, however, must be consistent with preserving and increasing regulatory benefits. Hence the need sometimes to trade the eraser for the blue pencil, even in our look-back efforts. OIRA has important responsibilities in the area of international regulatory cooperation under Executive Order 13609. We've made progress in a number of areas with our international partners through the Canada-United States Regulatory Cooperation Council and the Mexico-United States High-Level Regulatory Cooperation Council. OIRA has also furthered its international regulatory commission mission in coordination with the Departments of State and USTR, including activities in support of the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, known as TTIP, and their discussion of regulatory cooperation between the United States and the European Union. While the international role of OIRA is small compared with its key missions of regulatory review and implementing federal information policy, it is nonetheless an important part of our agenda going forward. I'd like to shift gears a little bit now and say a few words more specifically about cost-benefit analysis. That topic, of course, is one on which any OIRA administrator could interrupt not only your day today, but your mornings, noons, and nights for the next months. It is why all in my households, even the cats, sleep so soundly. So I wish here to make just three brief points. First, cost-benefit analysis is an essential tool for regulatory policy. I know that view is not shared by everyone, but if I did not believe it, I would not be OIRA administrator. Understanding what benefits a regulation will predictably bring to society and what society will predictably pay for those benefits brings both transparency and discipline to policymaking. It prevents stakeholders that would point only to the costs from hiding the good things that a regulation might bring. But it also requires those who would regulate to show that the regulation really will bring benefits and prevents them from achieving those benefits without regard to social cost. Except, of course, in those places where Congress has already made the decision that cost should not be a factor. My second point, however, is that cost-benefit analysis is difficult and must be done carefully. Indeed, such analysis can provide a misleading and incomplete picture when done badly or with bad inputs. Pitfalls of cost-benefit analysis are many. One big hazard is asymmetric quantifiability, if that is a word, of costs and benefits. Costs are sometimes much easier to quantify than benefits, which might give costs greater salience, even where benefits may be very large but harder to count. This is particularly so where the benefits are of a dignitary or quality of life nature. Another pitfall is that the information that allows quantification may be of poor quality. The resulting calculations are then not helpful to understanding the real social benefits or costs of a rule. And the exercise could lead to mistaken policy recommendations. And even the best available analysis and information may lead to costs and benefits that are highly uncertain on one or both sides of the calculation. These pitfalls do not mean that cost-benefit analysis should not be done, but they do mean that it must be done with care. Forcing the analytical framework onto a problem where it does not work is more obfuscating than illuminating. Finally, a word about costs. Regulations are often framed as imposing or creating new costs for society that did not exist before the implementation of the rule. Some rules do indeed create new costs, but it would be a big mistake and lead to bad policy to treat all regulatory costs that fall on particular entities as new costs of regulation. Indeed, regulation often shifts rather than creates costs. For example, it might well be possible for a firm to dump its garbage on its neighbor's lot rather than pay to have the trash hauled away. A regulation that bars such dumping would certainly add to the dumping firm's costs, but those are not new costs. They are simply repatriation to the dumper of the costs the dumper was previously imposing on its neighbor. This, of course, is a very coarse illustration of the well established phenomenon of externalities, costs that an activity causes but does not internalize and thus pay for. In the debate over the costs and benefits of rules, the alarmism that often accompanies discussion of costs needs to separate the internalization of externalities, that is, the shifting of costs back to the firm that causes them, from the wholly new costs that regulation creates for society. Society may sometimes make the judgment not to shift costs back to the activity that causes them and to bear them in a more dispersed manner, just as society will sometimes find the new costs that a regulation creates to be justified by the benefits of such regulation. But a more honest debate and better policy will emerge if the debate acknowledges the difference between creating costs and shifting costs back to their source to reduce harmful externalities. To conclude, it is a great honor for me to be serving as OIRA administrator at this time. There's a lot of energy in this administration towards moving forward in key areas of public policy, and the administrative mechanism of achieving those policy goals will be particularly important given the political atmosphere on Capitol Hill. We face a number of challenges in accomplishing those goals, but the office is fortunate to have an incredibly dedicated and talented staff that is working very hard to meet those challenges. We will continue over the next years to achieve the priorities discussed above and to work on ways continuously to improve the process of regulatory review going forward. Thank you very much.